The title of my dissertation is Credit Decisions and the Effects of Earnings Quality. Now, my general interest in finance pertains to the capital markets, and more specifically, the area of credit markets. And within the area of the credit markets, I'm interested in the determinants of the cost of debt and how lenders make their credit decisions. Consequently, you will see that my finance dissertation is comprised of three closely related essays where I explore earnings quality as one determinant of the cost of debt and how creditors using transaction-based lending incorporate the effect of earnings quality into their credit decisions. You're going to hear a lot about earnings quality in my presentation, and that's because I'm working in the overlap between finance and accounting. And the reason that I say the overlap is because accountants produce financial statements for the capital markets, and they're interested in understanding the behavior surrounding the use of those financial statements. And in turn, the capital markets are also interested in the behavior surrounding financial statements. Just to provide you an overview of what I want to cover this morning, I want to just share a little overview of this. And I'm going to start by providing just a global introduction of some of the underpinnings of my research. I'll introduce you to transaction-based lending, how earnings quality influences credit decisions. We'll take a look at earnings quality and then a brief look at what my sample looks like. Then I'll discuss each one of my three essays. Specifically, I'll give you a little bit of an introduction, look at the literature review, a hypothesis development, and the methodology. So in taking a look at transaction-based lending, again, I want to remind you that my dissertation is in the area of the capital markets, but I am in that overlap between finance and accounting disciplines because I'm talking about credit decisions. But these decisions are made with accounting data, and that data is obtained from financial statements that provide inputs into the transaction-based lending models. So I make reference to Berger and Udell, 2002, and they tell us that creditors use transaction-based models to determine credit worthiness. And they use financial statement data to be able to provide the input for transaction-based lending models. So since financial statements contain a lot of accounting data, I think the obvious question becomes, what data is the most important to lenders? And to help answer this question, I make reference to Gibson, 1983. And Gibson tells us that financial statement ratios are important to creditors. How did he know that? Because he conducted a survey of lenders that shared that information. And they said that balance sheets and income statements are the most important financial statements. In fact, 9 of the top 10 ratios can be derived from information contained in the balance sheet and income statement. And you can see that I have a table on the screen, and I selected the top 3 ratios valued by lenders from each one of these statements to serve as a proxy for the information content of each statement. Balance sheet ratios tell the lender something about the firm's ability to meet obligations, both in the short run and the long run, as well as something about the quality of the firm's assets. On the other hand, income statement ratios talk about the adequacy of the firm's earnings to service debt obligations. Now, I would like for you to note that earnings quality affects the usefulness of financial statements, but that not all statements are affected equally. in any particular year when earnings quality is low, income statement ratios are substantially impacted because they capture 100% of the effect. How can that be? Accounting earnings are found in the numerator of these three ratios. However, balance sheet ratios remain relatively unaffected when earnings quality is low because the effect on any one year is diluted on the balance sheet because of earnings from all the previous years. How? Because as a part of stockholders' equity, retained earnings represents an accumulation of all undistributed earnings since the firm's inception. Therefore, the usefulness of the balance sheet is not undermined to the same degree as the income statement in any one year. Lenders aware of low earnings quality should rely less on income statement data and more on balance sheet data when making credit decisions. So how does earnings quality influence credit decisions? Well, firms needing external capital, they can use equity capital or debt capital to finance their investment opportunities. And since my interest lies in the area of the credit markets, I'll be taking a look at debt capital. And in this case, creditors require information, financial statements, in order to be able to assess a firm's ability to service debt, something that can be referred to as credit risk. Creditors using transaction-based lending, they rely on accounting data to be able to forecast the level and the likelihood of future cash flows. Or another way that we could say that, they desire to assess the magnitude, the timing, and the uncertainty of those future cash flows. So the accuracy of forecasting these cash flows depends upon the quality of the accounting data. It is important to recognize that cross-sectional variation can exist in the quality of the accounting data because of reporting incentives. And by that, I mean that there's one set of financial statements, but there are different parties with a vested interest. You have investors, you have creditors, you have managers that all look for different information in those statements. So what do I mean when I talk about earnings quality? Earnings manipulations are actions or decisions that diminish the quality of information that can be associated with the financial statement data. In fact, accounting data can be manipulated in a couple of different ways, that of accruals, as well as real earnings management, something I abbreviate throughout my presentation as REM. You will see that frequently. So in the case of accruals, due to managerial judgment and the estimation that's involved with determining the amount of those accruals, they end up being less certain than cash and typically associated with more risk. Whereas real earnings management is referred to as a deliberate manipulation in the timing or the structuring of transactions to be able to increase short-term cash flows or profits. So information risk increases when earnings quality is low. The reason for it really doesn't matter, whether it's accruals or real earnings management. Before proceeding to the discussion of my essays, then, just want to provide you an overview of my sample. The source for my data is CompuStat, and I do look at the years 1988 through the present. I restrict the data in a couple of different ways. First of all, I just look at firms that have the data available for being able to compute all of the variables. And I include industry groups represented by at least 20 firms in any one year. I look at the 48 FAMA and French industry groups, and I do exclude financial services and utilities. All variables that I use as inputs are trimmed to remove the top 1% and the bottom 1% of sample firms. And I do that as a way of being able to help mitigate the impact of outliers. And then my earnings quality metrics are calculated from annual cross-sectional industry regressions. And I do that in order to be able to minimize the impact of time series issues as well as that of survivorship bias. So my first essay is titled Transaction-Based Lending and Accrual Quality. Accounting earnings include a cash component and an accrual component. Each component contains useful information. The accrual component, as I've just described, is inherently less certain than the cash component. Managerial judgment and the estimation involved can lead to measurement error. Also, management has incentives to be able to manage earnings. Information risk increases when accrual quality is low, so we're left with the question, can creditors depend upon financial statement data? My literature review consists of numerous articles, but these are the three that I consider to be the most important to share. DeChow, 1994, looks and finds that accruals improve earnings ability to be able to measure firm performance. Francis et al., 2005, finds that information risk increases when accrual quality is low, and that the quality of accruals is priced in both the debt and the equity markets. And finally, Maher, 2008, finds that private and public lenders demand higher rates of interest when accrual quality is low. In developing my two hypotheses, I've identified these four bullets listed on the screen as helping me to arrive at these hypotheses. First, accounting data, and in my case, ratios, serve as inputs for transaction-based lending. The balance sheet and the income statement, as Gibson, 1983, said, are the most important to lenders. Low accrual quality, therefore, will reduce the usefulness of the income statement. And if lenders price low accrual quality, then they must be aware of the implications for that financial statement data and modify their use of the data accordingly. So the two hypotheses that I've identified as this essay begin by taking a look at income statement ratios. And I predict that income statement ratios will have more incremental explanatory power for the cost of debt as accrual quality increases. So in other words, I expect that lenders rely more heavily on the income statement to be able to set interest rates when they know that accrual quality is high. And what do I mean by incremental explanatory power? Because you'll see that term frequently. In this case, incremental explanatory power is that of the income statement, the amount of information the income statement provides over and above that of the balance sheet. Or in other words, just the information that's unique to the income statement. H2, balance sheet ratios will have less incremental explanatory power for the cost of debt as accrual quality increases. In this case, we're saying that lenders will rely less on the balance sheet to determine interest rates when they know that accrual quality is high. The measures of accrual quality that I use, there are three of them. And I follow Maher 2008 in developing or using principal components analysis in order to be able to combine the results of these three accrual quality measures so that I can end up with a single parsimonious measure of accrual quality. So the first model that I take a look at is DeChow and DeChev 2002. In this case, we find that they indicate that all accruals should become cash, but to the extent that accruals don't become cash, then they're going to be considered abnormal and should be captured in the residual, which is right there. And you will see, as is listed up there, that I look at the absolute value of all signed abnormal accruals so that I end up with an unsigned abnormal accrual. Toe et al., 1998, looks at total current accruals as driven by changes in revenue. And abnormal accruals can be calculated in four steps with this particular model. First off, I run the regression by industry and year, regressing total current accruals on a change in revenue. Secondly, I take the resulting coefficients from that regression in order to be able to calculate expected normal current accruals. And I multiply those coefficients by the actual firm values. Thirdly, I calculate the signed abnormal accruals by subtracting normal current accruals away from total current accruals. And finally, in my fourth step, I take the absolute value of the signed abnormal accrual, resulting in the unsigned abnormal accrual. The third measure is the modified Jones model, as found out by DeChow et al. In 1995. In this case, we see that abnormal accruals are once again, they can be calculated in four steps. As I have done throughout my essays, I run the regression by industry and year. And here, note that I'm regressing total accruals, no longer the current accruals, but total accruals on the change in revenue and property, plant, and equipment. I take the resulting coefficients from that regression in order to be able to calculate the expected normal accruals for each firm in the industry. And I multiply those coefficients by the actual firm values. And then I calculate signed abnormal accruals, I subtract normal accruals from total accruals, and I end up with the absolute value of signed abnormal accruals, and that's the modified Jones measure of abnormal accruals. To test my hypotheses then, I utilize several different formulas. The top three equations that I use up here, I regress cost of debt on my control variables, the balance sheet ratios, and the income statement ratios, and that is what I consider to be my full model. The following two equations then, I regress the cost of debt, again on the controls, and this time just the balance sheet ratios, and in the third equation, just on the income statement ratios. And you can see the reason that I do that, we can follow down to my first hypothesis, and I direct your attention to this equation. I'm looking for the incremental explanatory power of just the income statement. In other words, that information that is unique to just the income statement. And how do I get that? I look at the information that is unique to both statements, the balance sheet, the income statement, and I subtract away the information unique to the balance sheet, leaving me with the incremental explanatory power of the income statement. I regress that on each accrual quality portfolio. And what I predict will happen is that as the level of accrual quality increases, that the incremental explanatory power of the income statement will increase. Therefore, the coefficient on this sign should be positive. In the case of the second hypothesis, much the same. I'm taking the full model, subtracting away the information unique to the income statement, and I'm left with the information unique to the balance sheet. I perform this regression, and I would expect as the level of accrual quality increases, the incremental explanatory power of the balance sheet should go down. Therefore, the sign on this coefficient should be negative. My second essay is entitled Transaction-Based Lending in Real Earnings Management. In this essay, I go to my toolbox and I pull out a different set of tools that can be used to manipulate earnings. So what makes this essay different from essay number one? It's the use of real earnings management. Why? Because the tools of real earnings management, they're more difficult to detect. Therefore, we see that they are used more widely since the passage of SOX in 2002, and they may be priced differently. So just some points to remember going into this essay. Accounting earnings consist of a cash component and an accrual component. REM can affect either or both of these components. REM refers to the manipulation of earnings through either the timing or the structuring of those transactions. And I've provided you with some examples on the screen. REM reduces then the usefulness of earnings for being able to predict future cash flows, those cash flows that are so important to lenders. And finally, information risk increases when real earnings management is high. The literature that is foundational to this essay consists of these three articles on the screen. The first one is Roychowdhury, 2006. Roychowdhury developed three metrics to be able to empirically measure the extent of a firm's REM activities and used those to show that, yes, firms do use real earnings management to avoid reporting accounting losses. Zhang, 2012, used two of Roychowdhury's three models, and Zhang defined real earnings management as I have been defining, a deliberate manipulation in that timing or the structuring of transactions. And my third reference is to Crabtree et al., 2014. And these authors found that REM is negatively associated with bond ratings and market yields on new debt issues. This suggests that creditors are not fooled by real earnings management. My hypotheses are developed based upon these four bullet points. And these are going to sound familiar to you. There is a common theme that comes through. Accounting data, financial ratios, they serve as inputs for transaction-based lending. the balance sheet and the income statement, as Gibson said, are most important to lenders. High real earnings management is going to reduce the usefulness of the income statement. And if lenders price low earnings quality, then they must be aware of the implications for the financial statement data and modify their use of the data accordingly. I've identified two hypotheses. The first one, income statement ratios will have less incremental explanatory power for the cost of debt as real earnings management increases. And I want to mention that in this particular case, then, earnings quality is decreasing. That's a little bit different than the first essay. So what am I saying in this hypothesis? Lenders are going to rely less on the income statement to set interest rates when they know that real earnings management is high. And H2, balance sheet ratios will have more incremental explanatory power for the cost of debt as real earnings management increases. In other words, they are going to rely more on the balance sheet to set interest rates when they know that real earnings management is high. I use Roychowdhury's models, and I use two of Roychowdhury's three models. I agree with Zhang 2012's approach to ignoring model number one. And Roychowdhury's first model looked at abnormal cash flow from operations. And the rationale is that some of the real activities that can be used, some can lead to abnormally high cash flow of operations, some can lead to abnormally low cash flow from operations. Therefore, inserting some ambiguity, and it can be kind of difficult to interpret the results. Therefore, I go with Roychowdhury's production model and discretionary expenditure model. So the production model, what this looks at is it considers production to be cost of goods sold and change in inventory. And this particular proxy then measures the overproduction of inventory. Abnormal production is going to be calculated as actual production minus predicted. So in this case, because we expect production to be higher than it originally was, this residual would be positive. Whereas in the case of the discretionary expenditure model, we define discretionary expenditures as research and development expenses, advertising, selling, general, and administrative expenses. And abnormal discretionary expenditures are calculated as the actual discretionary expenditures minus the predicted. And because the manipulation in this model would consist of cutting expenses, we would expect that actual minus predicted would result in a negative sign on this residual. Which brings me to the last point on the screen. Residuals are added together in order to be able to obtain a single measure of real earnings management. However, in order to avoid the two residuals, the negative and the positive, from canceling each other out, this particular residual is reverse coded so that they can be added together. My hypothesis testing for this essay should look very similar to essay number one. You'll notice that I use the same three models up here, starting with my full model and then two reduced models. I look for incremental explanatory power of the income statement, So that information that is unique to the income statement, and I take the full model and I subtract away that information unique to the balance sheet, leaving me incremental explanatory power of the income statement. So in predicting this particular sign, as the level of real earnings management in the different portfolios, as that increases, we expect the incremental explanatory power of the income statement to go down. Therefore, the sign on this coefficient should be a negative. With the balance sheet ratios in H2, I'm looking for that incremental explanatory power of only the balance sheet, full model, minus the information unique to the income statement, leaves me with that that is unique to the balance sheet. And as the level of real earnings management increases throughout the portfolios, I expect that the incremental explanatory power of the balance sheet, that it's going to increase. Therefore, a positive sign on the coefficient. And this brings me to my third essay, Pricing the Components of Earnings. Accounting earnings include a cash component and an accrual component. Each one of these contains incremental information not captured by the other component. Either component, as you now know, can be manipulated. What does that do then? It weakens that relationship between earnings and future cash flows, inserting risk into the situation. Information risk increases either when accrual quality is low or real earnings management is high. Therefore, are lenders aware of which earnings component is being manipulated, and do they price each component independently? My literature review on this essay is they're primarily based upon these three authors listed here. DeChow, 1994, I mentioned earlier. This takes a look and tells us that earnings are a better measure of firm performance. Accruals help improve the earnings ability to measure firm performance. Barth, Cram, and Nelson, 2001, find that accounting earnings include cash and accrual components that are useful in forecasting future cash flows, those cash flows that lenders deem important. In other words, they're a better predictor of future cash. And Kim and Cross, 2005, they look at and find that the predictive ability of cash hasn't changed. Even after 1988, when the statement of cash flows came out, that predictability has not changed. However, the ability of accruals to be able to help predict future cash has increased. In developing my hypotheses, I identify these key issues. The informational role of accounting is undermined by low quality earnings, regardless of which component of earnings is the source of poor quality. Creditors, they evaluate financial signals and they use that information that they obtain from financial statements. The use of transaction-based lending models help provide insight into how lenders operationalize the pricing of earnings quality. And lenders aware of increased information risk imposed by low-quality earnings, they can't be as confident in that financial statement data that they've been provided in helping to make their credit decisions. And because of that increased information risk, we would expect to see that pricing reflected in the interest rates. I have six hypotheses with this essay. H1, 2, and 3 relate to accrual quality. And for these three hypotheses, I utilize 10 portfolios, and I form them so that they are equivalent in real earnings management, but they differ in accrual quality. That is designed to be able to help me isolate the influence of those individual components. So H1, as accrual quality increases, the explanatory power of aggregate earnings for the cost of debt increases. H2, as accrual quality increases, the incremental explanatory power of the accrual component of earnings for the cost of debt increases. And H3, as accrual quality increases, the incremental explanatory power of CFO for the cost of debt is unaffected. H4, 5, and 6 look at the CFO effects of an REM increase. And for these three hypotheses, I test these using 10 portfolios that are equivalent in accrual quality, but they differ in the level of real earnings management. So H4, is the CFO effects of REM increase the explanatory power of aggregate earnings for the cost of debt decreases? H5, as the CFO effects of REM increase, the incremental explanatory power of the accrual component for the cost of debt is unaffected. And H6, as the CFO effects of REM increase, the incremental explanatory power of the cash component for the cost of debt decreases. My methodology in this essay starts off by looking at accrual quality. And I simply transfer this forward from essay number one. I'm looking at a combined measure of accrual quality. So I use principal components analysis in order to arrive at a single parsimonious measure. REM, that measurement follows what I did in essay two, using the two models that Roychowdhury developed. They are added together, of course, after reverse coding the discretionary expenditure model. Portfolio formation is going to be used to isolate then the contribution to earnings quality of each one of the components, cash and accruals. That's where I talked about forming the 10 portfolios. Each REM decile will be partitioned into accrual quality deciles. Then for each accrual quality portfolio, all equivalent decile ranks of accrual quality are going to be combined to form portfolios. These are portfolios that are equivalent in REM, but they differ in accrual quality. And then I take that same process and I reverse it and I form portfolios now that will be, they will differ in the level of REM, but they're identical in accrual quality. And my hypotheses that I finish off with here, I use the same approach, and I've been following this. This is from Kim and Cross, 2005, where I'm looking at incremental explanatory power. Once again, I have a full model, but this time, in addition to my controls, I'm looking at cash flow from operations, and I'm looking at accruals. I have a reduced model that I term the REM model, where I drop off the accrual component, and then I have a reduced model in this accrual model where I drop out the REM model. And then I calculate the incremental explanatory power of cash flow from operations by taking the full model minus the respective accrual quality. And in looking at the incremental explanatory power of accruals, it's the full model minus the explanatory power of cash flow from operations. And then just in order to help understand, I put my final hypothesis testing. I have the testing for accrual quality here, H1, 2, and 3. And then for real earnings management, H4, 5, and 6. And I even have my predicted signs that I share right there. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention this morning. Again, I appreciate you being here and your support. And now I invite your questions. And I believe that, Ariane, I turn that to you.
Thank you, Stephen. So first, the committee members will ask some questions, and we can open it to the audience. My first question was that in essay one, when you measured the accrual quality, you used this absolute value. To me, it seemed that if the accruals are really low, they would underestimate future cash flows. So if the accruals were negative, for example, they would underestimate future cash flows. So it'd be good information for the lender, better than expected future cash flows. Is there a reason why we use absolute value? Maybe a robustness check would be better if you just use the signed accruals, not the absolute value?
Okay. Great question. Thank you very much for that. I agree with you. I think that as a lender, I would certainly like to see those income decreasing accruals, the negative accruals. I think that would give me a much more conservative look. I have found that all of the literature that I have consulted, they do use the absolute values, that unsigned accrual. What I will do, even though I don't pretend to be an accountant, I'm working in that overlap, but I'm going to attempt to at least give you my thoughts on why I believe that they look at the unsigned measures. In my opinion, they do that first and foremost because that's really the nature of accruals. Accruals should be reversing. If I see a positive income increasing accrual in one period, I would expect to see that followed up by a negative income decreasing accrual in the next period. So that's basically my reason why I think they go with unsigned, because even though you might lean towards those negative income decreasing, which I might add would be fine if they're sustainable, but I would say chances are very good that when we see a negative income decreasing accrual, it is probably simply the reversal of a positive income increasing accrual. So therefore, I think the lender would need to be careful of that. And we also deal with a timing issue and how financial statement information, when it's made available. So if you take the case of, let's say that a credit decision is being made in the first quarter of the year T plus one. That financial information is actually coming from the period T minus one, because the financial information from the period T will not be available until second quarter of T plus one. So I think all of those items need to be taken into consideration. I can tell you, as a measure of a test of robustness, I do plan to go through and run these with signed values as well.
Okay, thank you. Another question I had was related to the contribution of the third essay. It seemed a bit very similar to the first two essays. I just wanted to clarify what would be the contribution of the third essay above and beyond the first.
And to me, in looking at it, it just really stems from that now I'm looking at the individual components of earnings. In essay one, I'm really looking at, well, essay one and two are looking at earnings management tools. So they are looking at the use of accruals as one tool, and in the second one, real earnings management as a second tool. The third essay breaks it down even further and isolates those individual components, that of the accruals and that of the cash, and seeks to determine, do creditors know when one of the components is being manipulated and quite possibly the other one is not? And that's not to say that there's not some form of manipulation in that other component, but that's why I formulate the portfolios like I do, in order to be able to isolate that impact. So to me, I see my contribution as those individual components, and do the lenders know when one is being manipulated, and do they price accordingly? Because I believe that, you know, the pricing becomes very, very important really throughout these essays, because I think if they're underpricing, there is the chance that in fact they've not priced properly for risk. If they're overpricing, does business go away possibly, or the opportunity to loan that money? That's what I see my contribution being.
Okay, thank you. And I also had two or three more comments. They are more cosmetic comments, they are not questions. But one thing you mentioned in the first essay, you measure the accruals by pharma French industries. One another alternative, maybe as a robustness check, would be to be done by SIC codes, four-digit SIC codes maybe. Another cosmetic comment would be when you use the second equation of the accruals, you get the estimates of the first regression model. So just to denote them with a little caret on top to estimate that to show that they are estimates of the coefficients. And also you eliminate 1% of the sample up and down to minimize the effect of outliers. Maybe also try Windsor rising them at 1% as an alternative.
Okay.
I also may have a question in the end, but I'll first leave it to the other committee members, and we come back. So maybe Charles, if you have any questions.
Hello.
Yes. Now I can hear.
Yes, Steve. I wonder, in the third essay, in the two cases where you're predicting null hypothesis, if you observe a significant coefficient, if you get significant incremental R squared increases in cash, say, when only accrual quality is given across portfolios, how would you interpret significant changes in the price of the cash component?
Well, for starters, I would expect them to be unaffected, but in the event that I would see that incremental explanatory power going up or going down, to me, that is a sign that the lender is not aware that that's what's happening with that. In that case, it would be the cash component. They're not aware of it. And so therefore, it may be a case they turn around and either don't know that it's there, or they turn around and maybe deliberately misprice, actually overpricing what that interest rate would be.
And in your accrual quality models, do you, so the accrual quality model you use in all three lessons, for the tone model and modified Jones model, you have variables 1 over lagged assets. What is the purpose of that variable?
That, the purpose of that is to be able to control for firm size. Because if you look at, if you had $10 of crude revenue over, say, $100 of total revenue, well, that's far more significant than if we had, say, $100 of crude revenue over $1 million. So therefore, it's important to scale that for firm size. We need to control for that.
Well, that's the purpose of the deflator, but aren't you essentially forcing intercept to be zero in that model by including variable 1 over lagged asset?
Yes, in that case, yes, that is exactly right. I believe that's what it's doing. I really haven't been able to find any kind of an explanation for that, but that's what I believe is happening, because I think the reason why is that in the case that sales were zero and say property, plant, and equipment would be zero, then accruals would have to be zero. That's how I would interpret that anyway. But I am following these three models. They have been in the literature for a long time. They're still being used today. So that's why I guess I don't question that.
And last question, why do you think the income statement is so important? I mean, Gibson was 1983. The statement of cash flows has been required since 88. You can't pay interest with accruals. So do you think the income statement has become less important now that we have a statement of cash flow?
I do think that the income statement is more important. We find, let's take for example, Dichow, 1994, and Dichow finds that earnings are actually a better measure of firm performance than cash flow from operations. Barth, Cram, and Nelson, they talk about the combination of accruals and cash actually being better predictors. They have the ability to better forecast future cash, which is what lenders are looking for. And even down to, I had mentioned in the essay, looking at Kim and Cross, 2005. Kim and Cross actually look at the two individual components of cash and accruals, and they find that the predictive ability of cash hasn't changed, but in fact the predictive ability of accruals have changed, and they've changed even more since 1987. And to me, all of that evidence points to that earnings is actually more important. And I think that lenders themselves, I don't believe that they can afford to be able to ignore that information that can be found in accruals. They're trying to forecast the future of cash flows for servicing debt. To me, and based upon prior literature, earnings has to be more important than cash flow from operations. And I can even, you know, follow that up, looking at something like, say, the tie ratio that looks at earnings over interest. Well, actually, that ends up being a more conservative reporting of the tie ratio than if we use the cash flow from operations in the numerator. So I feel like that the income statement is more important.
Thank you.
Thank you, Charles. Thank you, Stephen. Garrett might also have some questions.
Yes, Stephen. So a few questions relating to the sampling of your time periods and a few things like this. So methodological, it may end up being more robustness checks when you're running your results. So the first question, and this to clarify, when I read through your proposal, your cost of debt is all for public bonds, correct? So this is not like private bank syndicated loans or things like this.
Okay.
Is it that's correct?
Yeah, basically okay. That's true.
Okay. Certainly not the only driver, but the largest driver of cost of debt on a public corporate bond is the bond's credit rating.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't recall seeing a control variable in cost of debt relating to the credit rating of the bond. Was that correct?
You are correct in that, and my reason for that, whether it's valid or not, I don't know. That would be for us to decide. But my research design is dependent on being able to completely extract that information from either the income statement or the balance sheet when I do my hypothesis testing. And that if there is some type of a control in there for credit risk, for default risk in there, that when I go to that reduced model and I extract out the balance sheet information, I believe that if that's sitting in the control variable, I will not have extracted all of that information. That's why that I basically have not. My rationale is that I need to be able to remove any variable that would actually be correlated with the balance sheet or the income statement. Now, what I guess I have thought about is, or wondered about, is if there might be some other proxy that I could use. Maybe something like nearness to a debt covenant, possibly. I even wondered about like a going concern opinion, something that might not be correlated with that balance sheet information or income statement information. That was my thoughts.
Okay. So you touched on covenant in your response then. So another question I had is, have you considered looking at some of the covenants within the bonds themselves, even something like a call covenant? Because if bonds are callable and interest rates drop, given changing in interest rate environments, that would give potentially management more incentive to try to manage earnings going into that.
Yeah. I have thought about that too. And I guess I'm thinking that the existence of a debt covenant probably shouldn't be necessarily correlated with earnings quality. At least that had been my thought process. And I'll tell you, very honestly, another part of my thought process is, what information do I have access to? Do I have the ability? So your point is very valid. I'm not sure with CompuStat and our subscription to Words exactly what would be available, and potentially with the size of my sample, the thought of hand collecting anything.
Sure.
That's shakes me to no end.
I guess tying on, so even without having to worry about hand collecting, just considering changing in interest rate environments, that might be something for a subsample. If there was something to where the differential explanatory power changes, say, between high interest rate environment and the present low interest rate environment, that might be an interesting addition to the paper.
I wonder, and I also wondered, and I'm not exactly sure how this relates, but some of that seemed like it could relate to the magnitude of coefficients. And I know that because I'm looking at that change in R square, I wasn't sure if that would be as much of an issue, but I do think it's worth considering in your idea maybe of some kind of a subsample or something. If I would have access to that data, worth considering. Great point.
And then, so the very last thing, and I this was the one comment I included in my notes back from being a reader. But at least this shows up in the finance literature. Companies in general are issuing less and less very long-term corporate bonds, partly in response to the changing interest rate environments, but we don't see very long-lived corporate bonds being issued. And so this puts the corporation into a position where they have to reissue their bonds to keep their debt rolling. Mm-hmm. So a refinancing risk component comes into play with corporations. You know, will they be able to get the desired interest rate that they wish when they go to refinance their bonds? So if I'm a management team, and again, this plays to management's incentives. Mm-hmm. So if I'm a management team and I realize that in 2 or 3 years I'm going to have to issue debt, I have a much stronger incentive to manage my earnings to make sure I hit the debt target that I think I should be paying. Mm-hmm. So I would think that would be a component that you'd want to control for. So the nearness of refinancing risk.
And I remember that from your comments, and I guess had been mulling that over as well. Thank you.
Okay, I just had a couple more comments based on the question that came up. I remember there was a paper, I don't remember the author names, but they find that the main component that drives the credit rating of a company is the size of a company. So if you control for size, that would also capture some of the credit rating part that is not correlated with balance sheet ratios. All the assets is a balance sheet item, but it's not correlated with ratios. A couple of things you may want to control. Garrett mentioned the interest rate environment. Also maybe control for recession periods. During those periods, the default risk generally goes higher. So the interest rate of debt issued during those periods might be also higher just because of that. That could either be done by that or maybe include in the year fixed effects.
Okay.
So maybe something to consider. I have written them down so I could.
Thank you.
Also another question I had in your third essay, you'd have 10 portfolios controlled either by REM or by the accrual. And then are each of those 10 portfolios sorted 10 more times based on the other variable? So you'd have the sample size would be 100 or it'd be 10 in your third essay?
It'll be 10 is what it will be. Basically, if I go with deciles, and I'm still right. working with that a little bit, but if I go with 10 deciles, because I use ranking, I will rank those. And so, for instance, 10% of the firms will fall into, say, that first decile. And then I'll do the same thing with the measure of accrual quality then, and I'll put a tenth of the accrual quality will go into that first decile of REM. And then what I will do ultimately is then I'll take a tenth from the tenth of accrual quality from decile one, the top tenth from decile two, decile three of the REM, and they will come together to form those portfolios that differ on accrual quality but are the same for REM.
So ultimately it would be 100 observations.
Right, so it sounds like you're doing a dual sort.
I would say that is right.
Okay, that's right.
That is right.
Because if it was 10, only 10, I'd be worried about the power of the regression, so I'd suggest maybe using quintiles or percentiles or something like that. But
yeah, so I have the visual, but being able to communicate the visual into words is a little tougher.
Okay, thank you. Now we can leave it to the audience. Maybe they have any questions.
Thank you. Very nice presentation. I think you did a good job, especially I'm not in finance, and that was really clear, so nice work there. But you know, one thing I wasn't sure is what are the gaps you are trying to address? You were never really clear about whether these had been done before, and especially from the literature review, I couldn't get that. I thought in some cases it had been done already. So if you could let us know what gaps you're trying to understand. And the other thing we kind of emphasize in the program too is the practitioner aspect. So if you could talk about what the results would mean to the field one, but also to practitioners, I think that'd be great. But otherwise, really liked it.
Okay. In talking about my contribution, I really go back to Francis et al. 2005. And Francis, in her research, she uses Dichow and Dechev's accrual quality model from 2002. But she uses information from 1970 all the way up to 2001. And I feel like that what she has done is that she has taken information and put it into a regression for a model that didn't exist for the 30 years prior to that. She regresses cost of debt on accrual quality, and from that, she infers lender's price accrual quality. Well, they couldn't have been pricing her measure of accrual quality because her measure didn't exist at that point in time. So, and I'm not saying that lenders didn't have some form of measurement of accrual quality, but I think because of it being over a 30-year period of time, what I couldn't help but wonder is, what if there was some other variable in there that was, say, correlated with our modern measures of accrual quality? To me, and as my basic understanding of research is that would be a spurious correlation, as I see it. So I guess in all of that, Praveen, I feel like her inferences, they either need to be validated through additional support with what I am attempting to do with the use of income statements and balance sheet measures. So they either need to be validated and support added to them, or it's possible that my findings will undermine what she came up with in that. So that's what I am doing, is finding another way of getting at that, because lenders tell us that they use financial statement ratios, and by using financial statement ratios, they must be able to recognize earnings quality, because low earnings quality is going to impact that income statement, and therefore, I'm going to look and see, do in fact, they price accrual quality. So that's what I am looking at. You know, from a practitioner's point of view, I feel like the regulatory industry, I'm not sure exactly of all the regulating bodies, but I feel like through some of my research that there should be some findings that would help. I feel like for the lending community, I'm really hoping that I will be able to have some findings, maybe even that third essay, the pricing of those individual components, information that would be able to help lenders in that area. And through all of this, you know, definitely there's a number of different incentives throughout earnings management, and that there should be information there that can also benefit creditors, investors, managers. Thank you for your question.
Any other questions?
Just a quick thing. What type of sample size are you expecting to get after you narrow it down?
I ran some preliminary results on this, and I, forgive me because it has been a while since I have done this, but earlier I divided my sample into high accrual quality and low accrual quality, and I believe I had about 12,000 in each division, so somewhere around 24,000.
So just to follow on Arjan's point about making sure when you do those final calculations that you do have the statistical power for those final tests, so that's just a precaution before to not get to the end of it and say, oops.
Okay. Yeah, and there have been some other things through the research that I uncovered and other ways and other findings, and in some cases they mentioned they didn't have enough power because it ended up reducing their sample size too much. Thank you.
Just curious, since you're working off secondary data, you're using CompuStat data.
Yes.
Have you finished the analysis and found something either way to support your hypothesis or not?
Have I so far?
Yep. Have you finished your analysis? And
I have not. I did earlier, I ran some preliminary numbers on the first essay, and I found support for my first hypothesis, but I didn't find support for my second hypothesis. But again, that was way back in initial stages. Since then, I've added a few control variables, and I've gotten some other suggestions, some reasons why I didn't find support on my second hypothesis.
Again, to sort of follow up, maybe this is discipline specific, and one side of the story is what the data tells you, but are you also going to go talk to people, maybe do some expert interviews, and see whether there's some reconciliation of what you find from what the data has tell what has happened so far to what is in practice, whether it's going to change. I mean, I'm trying to see, are you going to also do some kind of talking to people in industry, collecting data, more qualitative data to support or go the other way? Yeah. I mean, again, I said this could be discipline specific, maybe finance doesn't do it, but I'm thinking whether that would add more value.
Yeah.
Which goes back to Praveen's thing of having contribution, the programs thing is contribution to practice, and instead of doing a very traditional kind of a dissertation, mm-hmm. adding some more value to it by the cross-discipline input that you got through the program. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm sort of getting at. Yeah.
I could certainly see how that would add richness. I don't have any intentions on doing that for my dissertation. I will say I'm interested in behavioral finance. That very much interests me. And at some point in time, I think especially in trying to stay in this stream that was kind of shared with us throughout the program, I'm beginning to get an understanding why you tend to operate in a certain stream. And I would like to, at some point in time, be able to incorporate that. I don't anticipate doing that at this point in time, but I appreciate your thoughts on that.
I just wanted to add that in finance, it's usually not common to seek industry feedback usually. Maybe it's because we have such richness of data through CompuStat, and in the sample size you mentioned about 24,000, so it'd be very hard. But generally, maybe in a future idea, in finance, papers that collect hand-collected data do tend to sell better and plays better just because of the unique data set. So that's a feature maybe to consider for the future. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
I probably could have done this without the mic, but while we were talking, the thing that is rattling around the back of my head. So again, so these are corporate bonds that are publicly issued, and so I know that you've been referring to the say the purchasers or the acquirers of the debt as lenders, but in reality these are really, you know, investors. They're, again, it's not really so much a bank. So, and Praveen's comment kind of sparked this as well. So again, I'm thinking if I'm an investor. Maybe I'm a portfolio fixed income manager. I still am not sure when I'm making my investment decision if I'm going to go physically to the income or the balance sheets and do my own analysis to see if the interest payments is correct, or if I'm just going to look at the credit rating, say the credit rating on the bond or like the spread. It looks correct given the credit rating, and I'm going to make my investment there. I'm not sure if that second level of analysis, if many investors are really going to do that.
That's a point I guess I hadn't considered it. You know, at this point in time. I don't know, that's something I'd have to look at. I hadn't even really necessarily thought about that side of it.
Okay. And I have some accounting literature that again goes into there's a lot of earnings management as it relates to credit rating papers. Mm-hmm. So again, maybe this is just, I might be complicating the issue more than it needs to be, but from a practical standpoint, okay. It might be. Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you, Stephen. I guess we'll conclude the presentation here. Charles, Garrett, and I need to get together to discuss a bit. But again, thank you very much.
Thank you.